Hi everyone, welcome again to my den. If I were to ask you to name a dangerous substance, one that could easily kill you if you mishandled it, you might think of nitroglycerin. Nitroglycerin is a liquid that is unstable and explosive and not to be trifled with, as we see in this video clip by Adam Smith of Mythbusters fame. But while nitroglycerin is undoubtedly dangerous, physicists have discovered a substance that could level an entire city using only a single gram. Do I have your attention? Let me tell you more about it in this episode of Subatomic Stories. It was in 1928 that British physicist Paul Dirac first tried to unify the laws of quantum mechanics and Einstein's theory of special relativity. He was successful, and the result is a mathematical expression called the Dirac equation. Solving the Dirac equation, even for a single electron, is challenging. But when the dust settles, the solution looks something like this, with both a positive and negative answer. The positive answer described the electron. But what about the negative one? Many people thought it should be ignored, but Dirac was confident that it meant something. He was right. Dirac had predicted the existence of antimatter. It was only a few years later that a young professor at Caltech by the name of Carl Anderson discovered the antimatter electron. The antimatter electron is called the positron. It has identical properties to the electron, mass, spin, size, you name it, except for electrical charge. The electron has a charge of negative 1, and the positron has a charge of positive 1. It took some time, but the antiproton was discovered in 1955. It's just like the proton, but with the opposite charge. The antineutron was discovered a year later. It is also electrically neutral, just like the neutron. Some people wonder if they have the same charge, how can they be opposites of one another? We now know it's because they have different quark makeup. The neutron is made of quarks, and the antineutron is made of antiquarks. Antimatter versions of every particle have been discovered. There are antiquarks, antileptons, antineutrinos. More bizarrely, there are things like antiphotons, but in that case, the photon and antiphoton are the same particle, just like in numbers, plus zero and minus zero are the same. Let me tell you three interesting antimatter facts. First is that antimatter is uncommon in the universe. Uncommon as in basically non-existent, except in very special circumstances. But we can make it in particle accelerators using Einstein's equation, E equals mc squared. That equation says that energy and matter are equal, but the truth is a bit more subtle. What really happens is that energy can be converted into equal amounts of matter and antimatter. This happens. In physics, processes usually work both ways. If you can convert energy into matter and antimatter, then you can convert matter and antimatter into energy. And then Einstein's equation teaches us something interesting. That c squared thing is a really big number, basically a 1 with 17 zeros. That means a little antimatter is a lot of energy. In fact, if you combined a gram of antimatter with a gram of matter, the energy release is the same as the nuclear explosion at Hiroshima. So, important safety tip, don't do this at home. Antimatter is dangerous. Luckily, antimatter is very hard to make. The most powerful antimatter manufacturing facility on the planet took a quarter century to make enough antimatter to brew 50 medium-sized coffees. So you don't need to worry. The second fact is that there is nothing all that dangerous about antimatter if it's not near matter. You could take antiprotons, antineutrons, and positrons and make antimatter atoms, molecules, everything. There could be an antimatter me, and nobody would be the wiser. It's only when matter and antimatter are mixed that things get dicey. The third fact is that the absence of antimatter in the universe is a surprise. During the Big Bang, there was a lot of energy, which should have converted into equal amounts of matter and antimatter, but we see no antimatter anywhere in the universe. We don't really know why. I mean, we have some ideas, but the truth is that nobody knows the answer. But we're working on it. It's an unsatisfying state of affairs, to be sure, but that's life on the frontier of human knowledge. Welcome to my world. I've made a couple of longer videos that talk about all of these things in more detail, including one where I meet an antimatter version of myself. It's an explosive experience. So that's a short introduction into antimatter. Now, what do you say? How about we get to viewers' questions? Hi guys, it's that time of the episode where I answer viewers' questions. There are some pretty good ones this time. Jason K. asks if electromagnetism and the weak force both originate from the electroweak force, why do they have different force-carrying particles? Hi, Jason. Oh boy. You don't pick easy questions, do you? The answer to that question is extremely complicated, but I'll try to give you the high points. Suppose you're outside and it's a hot and muggy day. You look around you and see you're surrounded by air. Nothing weird about that. Then the temperature drops, and what happens is that it rains. Thus, when the temperature is high, what you call air is a mixture of oxygen and nitrogen and stuff, but also with water vapor. The two things look completely alike, but when you change the temperature, you get a phase change for the water, but not for oxygen and nitrogen. Above some temperature, the air and water look the same. Below, they don't. So that's the first analogy. Now for the electroweak force. There is a temperature above which the electromagnetic and weak force seem to be the same. Under these circumstances, mass doesn't exist. Even weirder, electrical charge doesn't exist. Instead, the electroweak force has two sets of massless force-carrying particles, a single particle called a singlet, and which we'll call a B, and a trio of particles called a triplet, and which can be called W1, W2, and W3. These are the particles of the electroweak force. In this high-temperature environment, the Higgs field is zero. Now, we lower the temperature. Initially, the change in temperature doesn't matter. However, there's a specific temperature at which the conditions change, like when air can no longer hold water. At that temperature, a few things happen. First, the Higgs field goes from being zero to being non-zero. Now that the Higgs field isn't zero, the B and W particles can interact with it, and some of those particles get mass and some don't. The particles become the familiar massive W and Z bosons and the massless photon. I've skipped over some details, including some complicated quantum stuff, but that's the gist. The massless electroweak particles above the magic temperature become a mixture of massless and massive force-carrying particles below it. If you want to learn even more about this, there is a very accessible explanation by Flip Tanedo, a physics professor at the University of California, Riverside. He was a blogger for the website Quantum Diaries, and he is a gifted explainer of complicated physics topics. I've put several links in the video description if you want to read his explanations, and I really recommend them. They're very, very good. Matt H. asks how massless particles can have no energy, especially if mass and energy are the same. Hi, Matt. I'm glad to see that you're trying to reconcile the words you hear because they are indeed confusing. Not everybody digs so deeply. The reason for this is simple. The rules of relativity are much trickier than you generally encounter in explanations for the public. Take Einstein's venerable equation, E equals mc squared. While it's certainly right, it's simply a special case of the full equation. The full equation is the more complicated E squared equals mc squared, all squared, plus pc, all squared. E is energy, m is mass, c is the speed of light, and p is momentum. For a massless particle, we can set m equals to zero, and we get E equals pc. This is the proper equation for a massless photon. We can also see what happens if we set the motion of the particle to zero. This means setting the momentum, or p, to zero, and we get the more familiar E equals mc squared equation. Basically, E equals mc squared only applies if an object is motionless. I'm sure someone is going to mention in the comments the idea of relativistic mass, which is the idea that mass changes as velocity changes. That's simply not true. Now, before you have a heart attack over that or think I'm some sort of fringe relativity hater, no way. Einstein is totally right. It's just that science popularizations cut corners when explaining his ideas. Saying that mass changes with velocity is a bit dodgy, but it helps students intuitively understand the consequences of relativity. I've even taught it myself in classes. Sorry about that if you were one of my students. If you want to understand what is really going on and why the claim that mass increases as velocity increases is both right in one sense and yet wrong if you dig deeper, I made a long-form video on that subject. The URL of the video is in the description. In any event, the answer to Matt's question is that the equation E equals MC squared is a special case of the much more complicated equation, and this simplification is true only for stationary massive particles. The simplification for massless particles tells a very different story. Nick Lagg asks, if electromagnetism and the weak force can combine to the electroweak force, can the electroweak force combine with a strong force to become some single superforce? Hi, Nick. The short answer is that nobody knows, but most particle physicists think it will happen. There are two reasons, one of which is a bit dodgy, and the other is more persuasive. The dodgy one is just because unification of forces is what we've seen in the past. Besides the electroweak thing, there was the unification of electricity and magnetism into electromagnetism back in the 1870s, and Newton's unification of celestial and terrestrial gravity in the 1670s. Unification seems to be the way of things. That's the dodgy motivation. The more substantive reason is that we know that the strength of the three subatomic forces changes with energy. This is an established fact. And if we take the trends we measure in current experiments, we can project them out to higher energies, energies we can't currently test directly. If we do that, we see that the strength of the three subatomic forces all become the same at a specific energy. Now, that energy is very high, a quadrillion times higher than what we can currently study, and a lot of new physics probably awaits us between the two energy scales. So the real situation is probably more complicated. But if we just go with what we've got, we see that with the strength of the forces eventually become the same, and that is a serious hint that the known subatomic forces eventually become the same. And here's a kicker. We think that even higher energies, gravity joins the party, and there's just one force. Okay, so that's all the time we have for questions. There were some tough ones today. If you're liking the series, please like, subscribe, and share with all your friends. We want to get our numbers up. Higher numbers mean more people can enjoy the deep mystery of physics, and that would be a good thing, because even at home, physics is everything.